Thanks for checking out our message this week. We'd love to help you take your next step spiritually, no matter where you're at. The best way to start this process is to find the closest Saddleback campus by visiting saddleback.com/locations or visit our online campus at saddleback.com. To purchase the transcript of this message, visit pastors.com. Enjoy the message.
43 years and 2 months ago, in June of 1979, God birthed this Saddleback Church in my heart. While I was sitting in a dark basement in a university in Fort Worth, Texas, I was finishing up my seminary degree, and for 2 years I had been preparing to start a church somewhere. I just didn't know where. And if you ask Kay, in our little home in Fort Worth, I had maps all over the wall of the world and the United States as we were praying about, God, where do you want us to start a church? But on that hot summer day, and it was 102, 103 degrees in Fort Worth, God showed me, as in that basement of that university library, on some census statistic, the name Saddleback, Saddleback Valley. I had no idea how dear, how precious that name would become to me, because it consumed that word, Saddleback, almost every waking thought of my life for the last 43 years. It has been our privilege to love you. It's been our privilege to serve you. It's been our privilege to pray for you. I have been at the gravesides of many of your beloved family members. I have been at the bedside of thousands of you in hospitals. I have been with you in counseling and on the patio, and Kay has too, on the phone late at night and late night meetings. And I figured out this week that during those 43 years, I have taught over 6,500 sermons, Bible studies, devotionals, small group messages, video Bible studies, leadership lectures, leadership seminars, podcasts, conferences. I've taught literally all around the world in 165 nations. Today, Kay and I are teaching our last message that we will teach together. I'll do one more message next week, but this is the last message we will teach together. And so we decided to call this message, If I Could Only Say One Thing to You. What I would most like to say to you. And each of us are going to take a part of this message where we're going to share a single message that's on our heart that we feel very deeply about that we want you to remember. Now, as a gentleman and as a husband, I have invited Kay to share first. So give a warm welcome to my favorite Bible study leader in the whole world.
As Rick said, what I'm about to share, what he's going to share in a little bit, is the core message. For me, it's the irreducible minimum of what I know about loving and following Jesus Christ. It's the heart and center of me being a Christ follower. If you've been at Saddleback, some of you since the 90s, you've heard me say that, you've heard me talk about it before, you've heard me teach it, so it may be a repeat for you, but I'm so thrilled to be able to articulate one more time what it is that I would say to you after being here for all these years. The one thing, if we were sitting down having a cup of tea, eating a great donut, and we had the opportunity to share a little bit about our lives, somewhere in that conversation, I would say this to you. Say yes to God. Say yes to God. It comes from a passage of scripture in Mark chapter 8 that I rediscovered about 20 years ago, and it impacted me. The message of what Jesus says in those verses completely changed my life, and because of that, it became the core of what I want to share with you. And it starts with this conversation that Jesus has with a group of people. So in Mark 8:34, it just says simply that Jesus called his disciples and the crowds to come over and listen. One of the things that I do when I'm reading scripture is I try to visualize a scene. If it's a story or a narrative, I try to put myself in that scene and try to visualize what's happening there so that I can access the information, and it helps me feel like, oh, Jesus is talking directly to me. So picture with me this scene. Jesus is talking to a crowd, and he says to his disciples. It was not unusual for Jesus to be talking to a crowd or be followed by a crowd. He was followed by a crowd all the time. He could almost never get away from a crowd. He was this traveling rabbi that did miracles, and that caused quite a stir in that part of the country. So there were some people that were there today in the crowd who were curious. He was an oddity. It's almost like you would go to a circus to see, you know, this freakish thing. And they came because they were curious. They had heard something about Jesus, and they just wanted to check him out. There were also people in the crowd that day, I imagine, who were desperate for a miracle. Man, things had gone badly in their lives, and maybe with family members or within themselves. And some of them who knew had heard that this guy performed miracles, that he healed people, that he raised the dead, that he could make people who couldn't talk suddenly talk, and people who couldn't hear and restored sight. I mean, it was like, wow, I need that kind of a miracle in my life. My family member needs that kind of a miracle. So there were some people that were there in that crowd that day, not necessarily out of curiosity, but they were desperate for what Jesus could do for them. And then Jesus says, but my disciples are here too. He separated them. His disciples were men and women who traveled with him, who were learning from him, who were living life with him. And they were a very small, intimate group of people that were close to Jesus in a different way than the crowd was. And so the question that day was, how do people move from the crowd to being one of Jesus' disciples? And that's what we're going to talk about right now, because he draws a line in the sand. He's having this conversation with the crowd, curious, some desperate, some in need, his disciples a little separated over here. He calls them all together and says, let me tell you something about how to move from being part of the crowd to being one of my disciples. And I want to pause and just say that there is certainly a crowd here today. There is a crowd, and in this crowd, there are probably some of you that have come for the very first time to Saddleback. You've heard about it, somebody brought you, a friend, and you're curious. You've heard about this church through the years, and you came not necessarily because you were overly interested per se, but you were just curious to check out what was happening here. I'm also willing to bet there are some of you today that could relate to some of the people that were in the crowd that day with Jesus. You're desperate. You are desperate. You may have a smile on your face. You may look like you've got it all together, but underneath the layers, there is desperation in your heart and in your family. You need a miracle. There are some situations, some circumstances. You've gotten some news. Your marriage is falling apart. Your health is deteriorating. You've received a very heavy financial blow this week. Maybe you are not sure why you even exist. All you know is you're here today, and there is desperation in you to have some kind of a miraculous touch from God. You need something from him. I just want you to know that's good. That's okay, because all of us start out at some place on our faith journey needing something from God. All of us need something. There's nothing wrong with being in need and needing a touch from God. But what Jesus does that day is he talks about those who have started maybe from a place of needing something from God and have moved to disciple status, in which they are looking to give something back to God. And so Jesus lays out three very distinct markers, if you will, that show how to move from the crowd to being one of his disciples. It's so great that he doesn't leave it up to our imagination. He tells it to us very clearly. Look with me at the rest of Mark 8:34. So he said, he called as the crowd and the disciples, and then he said, if any of you wants to be my followers, he told them, you must put aside your selfish ambition, shoulder your cross, and follow me. In the Amplified Version, it says, Jesus called the crowd together with his disciples, and he said to them, if anyone wishes to follow me as my disciple, he must deny himself, which means set aside selfish interests, and take up his cross, expressing a willingness to endure whatever may come, and follow me, believing in me, conforming to my example in living, and if need be, suffering or perhaps dying because of faith in me. So I want to take just a quick look at these three distinguishing marks, or these three distinguishing decisions that can move us from being part of the crowd to being a disciple of Jesus Christ. The first is, he says, put aside selfish ambition. Put aside selfish ambition. A couple other words that explain that a little bit would be to deny yourself, to surrender to God. Those are some of the words that Jesus used. Well, to be honest, that's not a very pleasant or easy place to start, because most of us are not particularly interested in surrendering. We're not particularly interested in saying no to ourselves. We're not particularly interested in shifting our focus away from selfish concerns or selfish ambition. We're pretty much about us. I'll tell you the three things that have stood in my way through the years, continue to challenge me, and I have probably challenged you in some ways, at three things. First is our comfort. I just alluded to that. Comfort is one of the things that gets in our way. I call it the kingdom of K, because in the kingdom of K, I'm the queen. I'm the benevolent despot in the kingdom of K. I spend most of every day trying to arrange my life in such a way that I'm comfortable. And if you would be honest, I think most of you would say the same thing. There's a kingdom of you. There's a kingdom of Tom. There's a kingdom of Bob. There's a kingdom of Julie. There's a kingdom of Denise. It doesn't really matter. Each of us live in our own kingdom where we rule, and we really want the people in our lives to conform to us, to make us comfortable, to arrange things in such a way that our lives are as easy and simple as they can be. Am I right? Am I right? Don't we do this? Okay, the problem with that is instantly that comes in conflict with God. Because God says, I am asking you to stop putting yourself at the center and arranging your own kingdom, and that you would say yes to me instead of yes to yourself. I have a problem there sometimes. Control is the second thing where I've struggled, and imagine some of you do as well. For me, I'm a bit of a rebel. I genuinely don't want anybody else telling me what to do. I don't like to be told what to do. And we could explore all the deep psychological reasons, you know, why that is, look at my past, look at whatever. But the point is, as I stand here today, I don't really like to be controlled, and I don't really like people telling me what to do. I'm a bit of an oxymoron, though, because I'm also quite the rule follower. But the deal is, I like my rules. I like rules that make sense, and I frequently think my rules make sense, and I will only like your rules if I think your rules make sense, and usually your rules don't make as much sense as my rules, and so I like control. Again, instant conflict with God, because God is asking those of us who want to be disciples that we turn over the control of our lives to God. That's difficult. That's not an easy thing to do. I think the third thing that stands in the way sometimes becomes a barrier to our full surrender to God is fear. This one is not quite as obvious. To me, comfort, obvious. I'm the queen in the kingdom of K. Get that. I don't like control. Get that. Fear is a little more nuanced. But somewhere in my faith journey, I got the idea that if I fully said yes to God, I mean like just laid it all out there and said, God, I am yours. You can do with me as you want, anytime, anywhere, any place. I belong to you. That to really do that from the depths and the core of who I am, that God's response would be to hurt me. That God's response would be that the bottom would fall out of my life, that the wheels would come off the bus, that everything would go to hell in a handbasket in about 3 seconds if I fully surrendered to God. Like he's this cosmic guy sitting up there waiting for us to say yes to him so that he can go, that was the moment I was waiting for, now you look what I'm gonna do. As though that's the kind of God we're dealing with. It's not. God is good. That is a misperception and a complete character assassination of God. If that is our approach to him, if we think that if we really say yes, that he will unleash havoc in our lives in response, it causes us to try to withhold parts of ourselves, like withhold relationships. We play this deal or no deal with God. God, I will love you, I will serve you, I will be yours, but don't touch my children. God, I love you, I will serve you, I'm yours, but don't you touch my marriage. God, I love you, truly, I'm yours, but if you leave my family in need, all bets are off. And we act as though we need to protect pieces and parts and parcels of our heart and our affections and our relationships from God, because if we give them to him, he might, what? Take them away. Such a misunderstanding of God. God is good. Listen, I have had breast cancer and melanoma. My mother had Alzheimer's and suffered for 10 years and died 2 years ago. My beautiful daughter-in-law nearly died from a brain tumor. My son took his life. But I want you to know that I did not get breast cancer and melanoma because I said yes to God. My mother, who loved Jesus with all her heart, did not end up with Alzheimer's because she surrendered to God. My daughter-in-law did not end up nearly dying from a brain tumor because she surrendered to God. My son didn't take his life because I fully surrendered to God. Those things happened because there is evil in this world. And evil will come, as my friend Beth Moore says, evil will come because evil will come. But those who have not withheld themselves from God will find him enough when evil comes. You guys, this is a very broken world. As I said, some of you sit here needing miracles. There's desperate need in your home, in your family, in your life, in your personal life. And you do not need to be afraid that if you fully surrender yourself to God, that his response will be to allow evil to harm you because you said yes. Evil will, some of you already have experienced evil's work in your life. Evil will come because evil will come. But God is good. And we can surrender ourselves. We can say yes to a good God. The second distinguishing mark of, or how to move from being part of the crowd to being Jesus' disciple, it's a hard one. If that first one wasn't hard, it gets a little bit harder from here. Because what Jesus says is, in verse 34, a disciple must shoulder your cross. The Amplified says, a disciple will take up his cross, expressing a willingness to endure whatever may come. Whew. Visualize the scene again. Jesus is talking to this crowd of people. He's talking to his disciples. And I wonder, I'm just speculating if out of the corner of his eye, in the periphery of his vision, Jesus didn't notice a man over here carrying a cross up to the site of crucifixion where he would die. And it reminded Jesus to say to these who were listening to them, I identify with that man because I too am going to shoulder a cross and die. And if you want to be my disciple, there will come a time and a place in your own life in which you say yes to God that says, God, if you ask me to shoulder a cross and die for my faith, for my following you, then I'm willing. The Bible says in Romans 5:8, that God shows his love for us, that in while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. See, it was not unusual for Jesus to see somebody carrying a cross in his day and time. It was one of the favorite modes of of terror and cruelty for the Roman government to execute people on crosses, to crucify them. That's what they did with criminals. And it was a public spectacle. You didn't only have the terrible death of dying on a cross, you had the public insult of having to carry your... Jesus wasn't the only one who carried a cross through the streets of Jerusalem. Many, many, many people carried a cross through the streets on their way to what? Die. The thing is, nobody ever picked up a cross in that time unless it was to go to their crucifixion. So when Jesus says to us, if you want to follow me, there needs to be and come a time in which you're willing to say to me, if this is what you ask of me, this is what I give. There were no such thing as cross tattoos, cross embroidered bookmarks. There were no cross necklaces or bracelets, because a cross was an instrument of torture. It'd be the same as if today we had a tattoo of an electric chair or we had a necklace. It was like, oh, that's disgusting. That's gross. That's horrible. Nobody would do that. But a cross is what was an instrument of death. Now, Jesus redeemed it. He gave it new meaning. He was so disturbed in heaven, where it was perfect, where he reigned with God. He's God, he reigned, but he was so disturbed by the fact that humanity was separated from him. Humanity did not have a relationship with him. He was disturbed enough by that to leave heaven, come to earth, knowing that what was ahead for him was to shoulder a cross and take it on our behalf. He did that for us. And so it begs the question for us as we think about, what does it mean to follow Jesus? Yes, it does mean to deny myself. And you could call that, if you will, carrying a cross. And there is an element of carrying a cross for Jesus by the way we deny ourselves. But there's also this point that was very noticeable to the crowd that day. A cross means die. So if you and I are going to follow Jesus fully, we have to be disturbed enough about some of the evil, some of the brokenness, some of the pain, some of the suffering in our world, that we move from that place of comfort and control, and we say, God, if you want me to give my very life on behalf of others in the way that you did for me, my answer to you is yes. If you are willing to grapple at this level with Jesus, with God, about your commitment to him, and you take those baby steps of saying, yes, God, I want to learn what it means to deny myself, to set aside the focus on my own selfish ambition. I want to be willing to be disturbed by what I see in this world to the point that if you ask me, I will give you my very life. It will ruin you. It will ruin you. And it will take you to this third mark that Jesus laid out. It sounds so simple. Follow me. Those sound like the simplest words in the English language. Doesn't sound like a very high bar. But then you see what Jesus said about following him. He said, believing in me, conforming to my example in living, and if need be, or perhaps dying, suffering, or perhaps dying because of faith in me. I think what Jesus is saying here is that the reality is most of us will not be called to give our lives for the sake of Jesus. That is the reality. In a crowd this size, there will be very few people who are actually asked to give their lives for on the behalf of others in the name of Jesus. I think what Jesus is saying right here is there are many, 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 many more of you that I'm asking to live like me. I'm asking you to live like me, Jesus says. I'm asking you to follow my example of living, and that your daily life, your existence, becomes about living the way Jesus lived his life. I think this means letting Jesus go beneath the waterline of what everybody else can see, and let him dig around into all the different aspects of your personality, of your personhood, of the things that matter to you, and let him transform you so that you live in much more of the way that Jesus did. I firmly believe this, that if you are today, if your main goal is to pursue the American dream, health, wealth, happiness, that your life is pretty much about the pursuit of the American dream, it will ruin you. It will ruin you. It's not a worthy goal. But following Jesus to the end, wherever that end is, will also ruin you. You're not going to be necessarily great company at dinner parties because you are thinking and feeling and responding and living on a different level, a different plane. It will ruin you. But if you're going to be ruined, why not be ruined for the kingdom of God, which will last way beyond anything else in this earth? This kingdom that Jesus talked about was surprising then and in some ways more surprising now. I think we are further away from understanding what it means to live as Jesus lived for his kingdom than it did even then. Jesus' kingdom was upside down. It still is. Jesus' kingdom was not about the strong and the powerful, but it was about elevating the weak and the powerless. Jesus' kingdom was not focused primarily on beautiful and affluent people, but on people who were wounded and poor. Jesus' kingdom is primarily about not those most likely to succeed, but about those least likely to succeed. His kingdom is not about insiders, but outsiders, about not people who are in the middle, but people who are on the fringes and the edges and the margins. That is the kingdom that Jesus came preaching, and it is far, far, far from what we understand, particularly in our Western culture, about what the kingdom of God is about. God has compassion for the least and the lost and the last, and we say that we do, but where in our lives is that lived out? Where do we live out that commitment, that passion, that dedication, that focus, that effort toward people that are at the heart of the kingdom of God? Colossians 1:15, simple verse, but man, is it profound. Colossians 1:15 says that Christ was the visible image of the invisible God. Nobody's seen God. Nobody knows exactly what God is like. We have his word that tells us. We had his prophets that tried to tell us. And so God sent Jesus, God with skin on him, to make the invisible God visible, so that we could get a clue. How do we know what God is like? Look at the life of Jesus. And now Jesus says to us, I'm asking you to follow me and to live a life the way that I lived. Because in so doing, you too will make the invisible God visible. You know, I think that there are moments, there have been in my life, I'm going to assume there are in yours, in which you have been unsure of your purpose, of your reason for being. What should your job be? What is your task in this world? I think that this passage from Mark and this passage from Colossians makes it so clear. Every single day, regardless of where you actually are employed or what work you do or what the life you're living is, somewhere every single day, the job description for your life and mine is to get up and make the invisible God visible by the way I live, so that people know who God is. If you decide to do this, you'll resonate with what Jesus said in the last verses there on your outline. Jesus said, if you try, now first of all, I want you to visualize you're in that crowd that day. You're sitting there, and Jesus is saying these words to you. Listen to these words, not as me reading them, but as Jesus speaking to you that day and right here. If you try to keep your life for yourself, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake and the sake of the gospel, you will find true life. And how do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your soul in the process? Is anything worth more than your soul? I believe that Jesus is asking that this morning. He's asking you to take a very whole, hard look at yourself, at your life, and answer, be able, this question: is there anything worth more than your soul and how you live this life? Powerful, penetrating words that speak of the futility of withholding any parts of ourselves from a good God. It speaks of the barrenness of living for self instead of for Him, the pointlessness of existence that is dedicated to self and self-ambition and self-interest. And it asks that question: what is more important than your soul? So, what are you withholding from God? What do you need to give to a God who's good and who loves you, knowing that evil will come? It will come. But if you've not withheld any part of yourself from Him, He will be enough for you when evil comes. Where are you, like me, often addicted to running your own life? Where can you surrender? Where can we take off these crowns from the king and queen in the kingdom of me? What disturbs you? Listen, I know that most Americans are disturbed. All I have to do is open social media and know that millions and millions and millions and millions and millions and millions and millions of Americans are disturbed about a lot of things, and most of it is garbage. Where are we disturbed about the things that are on the heart of God? I want to know. I want to be disturbed about the things that disturb God. Will you follow Him? Will you live for Him no matter what? Will your answer to Him be, yes, God, yes? This is something you grow into. This is not something that you instantly put on like a sweater. This is something you grow into. But if you do, you will become a dangerously surrendered, seriously disturbed, and gloriously ruined follower of Jesus Christ, who knows every single day that your task, get up, make the invisible God visible by the way that you follow Christ. Rick is going to share from his heart the things that matter the most, the one thing that he would like to say to you today. I love you, Saddleback.
You know, I love this theme that Kay chose, say yes to God. It's simple. It's not easy, as she explained. Because when we talk about denying self, taking up a cross, and following Christ, it's more than just words. It's a radical restructuring of our priorities. And I want to talk to you about one implication of that. How do you live and follow Christ? How do you say yes to God day by day? Well, if I could only say one last thing to you as your pastor, I want to say this: live a life of love. Live a life of love. Inject love into everything you do, and express love to everyone you meet. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, well, Rick, I already live a life of love. Are you sure? Are you sure? I'm not talking about loving your family and loving your friends. That's easy to do. Anybody, even an atheist, can do that. Loving your friends, loving your family, loving those who are lovable doesn't require God's Spirit in your life. Not at all. Anybody can do that. But living a life of love means you make a conscious effort to show love to anybody and everybody and all people with no exceptions, regardless of how they look, what they believe, how they vote, and every other difference that we see in our society. Now, this idea of living a life where love is your top priority, where love is your highest goal, far more important than you realize. Just like saying yes to God sounds simple, but has deep implications. Living a life of love sounds simple, but it has deep implications. So I want to show you just a few of the many Bible verses in Scripture on what God says about making love your highest aim, your greatest ambition for the rest of your life. If there's anything I can leave you with, it's this: live a life of love. Let me look at some scriptures with you. First, Ephesians chapter 5, verse 2 says this: live a life of love. Just as Christ loved us. Kay talked about that. He gave his life for us. He gave himself up for us as an offering and a sacrifice to God. Are you seeing a theme here? What Jesus did, he wants us to do. Notice that God gave us a model for learning how to love everybody. And that model is Jesus. Now, if you're taking notes on that passage of Scripture, circle the phrase, just as. It says we're to live a life of Christ just as Christ did. That means I'm not really living a life of love until I love just as Jesus loves. Oh boy. That's more than loving family and friends, people we like, people who are nice, people who look and smell and talk and think and believe and vote like we do. How does Jesus love? This verse that I just read gives us three ways Jesus loves. Look at it again. It says this: live a life of love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as an offering and sacrifice to God. Notice, first, he gave himself up for us. Circle that. Gave himself up. Do you see a theme? Kay just talked about this. Giving yourself up. Denying yourself. Circle that. It's easy to give gifts. It's easy to give money. It's easy to give affirmations. It's easy to send texts to people you love. But let me ask you this. Who are you giving yourself up for? Anybody? Are you giving yourself up for anybody besides those you already love? Next, I want you to circle the word offering and sacrifice on that verse. Offering and sacrifice. These words mean that Christ-like love takes the initiative. Offering means you offer. You take the initiative. You don't wait for people to come to you. Christ-like love also, it says, sacrifices. It costs something. In other words, there's a personal price to pay. To offer anything means that you don't wait for somebody else. You take the initiative. You offer to give it. You don't wait to be asked. You offer love to people who may not even realize they need it. And then it says you sacrifice. You give yourself up, you offer, and you sacrifice. Now, you know, in baseball, sacrifice means that you are willing to give up your position and you know, hit a foul ball or strike out or whatever. You give up your position so that somebody else can score. That's exactly what Jesus did for you when he sacrificed for you. He gave up his life so you could score. So loving like Jesus includes giving yourself, offering yourself, and sacrificing yourself for people who may not even be so lovable or even appreciate that you are giving, offering, and sacrificing. So, when does God want you to love like that? Next verse. 1 Corinthians 16:14 says this: everything you do must be done with love. Whoa. There's no wiggle room in that verse. Everything you do must be done with love. Everything? Yeah. Even little things? Yeah. You can think of 1,000 ways to show love in everything you do. You could give somebody your parking spot out of love. you could say a kind word to everybody you meet out of love. You can refuse to be snarky on social media out of love. You can overlook an irritation. Everything literally means everything. Now, I know you say, I know, Rick, this is a nice ideal. Everything you do in love. But is it really that important? Next verse, Colossians 3:14 tells us, love is more important than anything else. I don't know how to get any clearer. Love is more important than anything else. Love is what holds you together when you're coming apart. Holds you together in perfect unity. Now, wow, that verse is really counterculture because he says being loving to others is more important than anything else. Is it more important than success? Yeah. Is it more important than wealth or fame? Yeah. Is love more important than getting even? Yeah. Is love more important than being right? Yeah. Is love more important than being understood? Yes. Everything means everything. Love is more important than anything else. How do you know what's really important to you? You look at four things. One, how you spend your time. Two, how you spend your money. Those things show what's important to you. Three, what you think about most shows what's most important to you. And number four, what makes you angry the fastest? God says being in love and being loving and acting in love is more important than anything else. This is not some minor issue that I'm talking to you about. And then look at the next verse, 1 Corinthians 14:1. I love this in the Message. It tells us, seek a life of love as if your life depended on it, because it does. Okay. I hope you're getting the message here. Living a life of love is the thing God wants more than anything else from you. He says, seek a life of love as if your life depended on it, because it does. What does it mean to seek? It means you search for something with all your heart. You don't just do it casually. It's a pursuit. It's a pursuit that you keep going on until you get it. To seek means to focus. It means to give your total attention. Let me ask you, what gets most of your attention? You ever thought about that? I think about it all the time. What gets most of my attention? What do you typically focus on most each day? God says, I want your first goal in life to be love. I want your highest aim in life to be love. I want your greatest ambition in life to be love. To live a life of love and show it to everyone. Now, when you look around our culture, do you see anybody whose greatest goal and passion and ambition is to learn to really love others the way God does? No. Because instead, we're not seeking love more than anything else. We're seeking comfort more than anything else. We're seeking safety more than anything else. We're seeking pleasure or popularity or power. We're seeking wealth. We're seeking self-centered goals. We're seeking everything but living a life of love. What am I saying? All of these verses, and I could have given you dozens more, reinforce the exact same truth. Learning to love better. Better than you are right now. Yeah, you love. But you need to go a lot deeper, so do I. Learning to love better should be my first priority for the rest of my life. Will you do that? Will you make learning to love better the first priority for the rest of your life? Why should I do that? Well, let's look at another passage. You know the famous passage in Scripture on love is called 1 Corinthians 13. It's Paul's love letter. It's quoted at weddings everywhere. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, first three verses, verse 8 and verse 13, gives us four powerful reasons on why this ought to be your top priority in life. Not anything else. This ought to be your top priority in life. Because it details in 1 Corinthians 13 how love or life minus love equals nothing. And in these verses, God, it's interesting, as I studied them this week, God attacks the most common sources of pride. He attacks the most common things that we find our identity in. You know, some people pride themselves on how well they communicate. And because they're good with words, and they can persuade people, and they may be even able to inspire people with what they say, and they build their identity on their speaking gifts and their communication skills. But you know what God says? God says this: if I never learn how to really love, write this down, nothing I say will matter. Doesn't matter how great a communicator I am. If I don't say it in love, nothing I say will matter. Verse 1, I may be able to speak in many languages of people or even of angels, but if I do not have love, I'm only a noisy bell or a crashing cymbal. I try to teach pastors all around the world that sermons without love, Bible studies without love, devotions without love are just noise. God says, if I speak without love, it is nothing. It doesn't count. Now, there's some other people in life who pride themselves on how intelligent they are or how smart they are, and they get their identity from their smarts, or they're proud of how educated they are, and they've got a sharp mind, and they can grasp and understand things faster than other people. And so they enjoy impressing people with their knowledge about things. And they may even be an expert in problem solving, or they may just always seem to be in the know. Some people aren't educated, but they're always in the know. They know about any news before anybody else does. They know about any gossip before anybody else does. Or they may be a walking storehouse of Bible knowledge, like the Pharisees were. But you know what God says? God says, if I never learn to really love people, nothing I know will matter. Write that down. Nothing I know. Not only nothing I say will not matter, nothing I know will matter. First half of verse 2 says this: I could have the gift of prophecy, and I could understand all mysteries, and I could have all knowledge, which means you know it all. I could know it all, but he says, if I don't have love, same conclusion, I'm nothing. Zip, nada, zero. Doesn't matter what I know, doesn't matter what I say, doesn't matter. If I don't have love, there's a third group that 1 Corinthians 13 talks about. That third group of people pride themselves on their accomplishments. And a lot of us are in that group. They're high achievers. You live in Orange County, means you're probably a high achiever, or in Southern California. And the world idolizes high achievers, people who get things done, who accomplish stuff. And these people can be entrepreneurs. And they got faith to take on big risks. They've got faith to make things happen. They're mountain movers who achieve the impossible. But you know what God says about that? When you try to find your identity in those things, God says that if I don't really love people, then nothing I accomplish, write that down, nothing I accomplish will matter. That's the third thing Paul says. Look at the verse 2, the second half of the verse. I could have faith so great that I could move mountains. But even with this, if I do not have love, I am still nothing. He's just tearing down all of the stakes and all the stilts that prop up society. Finally, there's some people who pride themselves actually on how good they are, on how unselfish they are, on how charitable they are, and how philanthropic they are. And outwardly, there are people who appear to be generous, and they appear to be giving, and they appear to always be helping people with their charity and with their philanthropy, but they don't do these good things out of real love, out of real love for God and real love for people. They're charitable because it makes them feel noble. They like feeling needed. They like feeling my charity makes me better than you. And they get their name on a wall somewhere. Besides, it's a good tax deduction. But you know what God says about that? Fourth thing, God says that if my motive isn't love, number four, write this down, then nothing I give or sacrifice will matter. It's all about love. Look at this, verse 3, 1 Corinthians 13. If I give away all my possessions to the poor, and even sacrifice my body to be burned as a martyr, you'd think that'd get the smile of God. It says, if I do not have love, I gain nothing. What is he saying here in Scripture? He's saying that God cares more about why you do something good than what you do, or even how you do it or how well you do it. 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 7 says, man looks at the outward appearance, but God looks at the heart. God is more interested in why you do what you do or than how or when or where. Now why, all of these verses are like nailing the nail deeper and deeper and deeper. Why is love such a big deal to God? Why should living a life of love, the kind of love that Christ lived, be the number one priority for the rest of my life? Because God wants us to become like him. God is a lover. God is a giver. God is generous. Everything we have is a gift of God. And the Bible tells us that God is love. How many times have you heard me say the only reason there's any love in the universe is because our Creator is loving? God is love. It's his character, its essence, his nature, and you're made in his image. Now, God wants us, his children, to learn how to love, like father, like son, like father, like daughter. God wants his children to learn how to love on earth, and earth is the laboratory for learning how to love. Why didn't God, when he makes us, just take us to heaven? Why does he put us here? He puts us here to learn how to love him and to love others, our neighbor as ourselves. First, God wants us to learn to love God. And then second, he wants us to learn how to love other people. If you don't learn these two skills in life, you miss two of the five purposes that God puts you on this earth. So let me summarize everything I've been saying. Galatians 5:6 sums it up this way. Galatians 5:6. The only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love. Pretty clear. The only thing that counts. I can be a great communicator. I can achieve a lot of things. I can be a giver and generous and a philanthropist. I can do all these other great things. But if it's not done with the motive of love, if it's done for self-aggrandizement or purpose of popularity, it doesn't matter. How can I learn? How can I learn to love better? Because I want to be a better lover. In Scripture, God gives us many, many ways to grow in love. I've just scratched the surface. But let me just get you started today with three simple steps. These are like first baby steps, okay? Write these down. Here's how you get started for the rest of your life in making love your top priority, learning to love like Jesus. Number one, keep reminding myself how much God loves me. That's the first step. Keep reminding ourselves how much God loves me. We love because God first loved us. Now, how do you do that? How do I keep reminding myself? Well, you build it into a habit. Build a habit of somehow every hour thinking about, God really loves me. What has God done for me? And reviewing the goodness and graciousness and greatness and grace of God. You might want to, this week, just to start this habit, set an alarm on your phone, maybe once an hour, and when that thing goes off, remind yourself, pause, how much God loves me. In John chapter, 1 John chapter 4, verse 7 and 11 says this, love comes from God. It gets perverted, but all love comes from God. And God showed how much he loves us by sending his only son into the world so that we can have eternal life through him. This is real love. And the rest of the verse says this, and since God loves us that much, we surely ought to love each other. Anytime you don't feel like acting in a loving way, and that happens to me a lot, you've forgotten how much God loves you. At that moment, you've forgotten how much God loves you. We love because he first loved us. God never stops loving you, even when you act in unlovable ways. How many times have you heard me say, you can't make God stop loving you? So if you want for the rest of your life to be different, to learn to live a life of love where it's the top priority, it's the highest aim, it's the greatest goal, start reminding yourself constantly throughout the day how much God loves you. Here's the second thing. Spend more time with God and his word. This is the fastest way to develop a loving mindset and a loving lifestyle. 1 John 4:17. As we live in God, our love grows more perfect. As we live in God, our love grows more perfect. You know, anytime you spend a lot of time with anybody, you start picking up their traits, good or bad. So spend more time in God's word. I would suggest you start with the book of 1 John. Start reading it this week. You want to be a more loving husband? Spend more time with God. You want to be a more loving dad or mom or wife? Spend more time with God. You want to be a more loving friend? Spend more time with God. And then, of course, when you're spending time with God, you're looking at his word. But you can pray about this. God wants you to ask him to help you act in more loving ways. You have not because you asked. You know, there are many prayers in the Bible, particularly the New Testament, about love. Here's one on your outline, Ephesians 3:17. Listen to this. This is beautiful. Get this metaphor. I pray that love, Ephesians 3:17, I pray that love will be the ground into which you sink your roots and on which you have your foundation. So let me ask you, is your life right now rooted in love? Or is it rooted in what Kay called the kingdom of me? Is it rooted in self-centeredness? What's your foundation? You know, a lot of people plant their roots in the ground, but it's the wrong ground. They plant their roots in the ground of resentment. They plant their roots in the ground of blaming other people for all their problems. They plant their roots in the ground of prejudice, bigotry, fear. They plant their roots in the ground of anger or selfishness. You know, you can always tell where people have rooted their life by looking at how they react to people. Jesus said it like this, you can know people by their fruits. The fruits of your life is what everybody sees. People can't see the roots of your lives, but they can see your fruits, and your fruits are determined by your roots. So to be loving all the time, you gotta be rooted in God's love. Spend time with God every day. Third thing, practice choosing to act in loving ways. Now, I intentionally use this phrase, practice choosing to act in loving ways. Choosing to act in loving ways because it corrects two big misconceptions about love. First, love is a choice. People act like, well, I just fell in love. Like, what? You didn't have any choice. No, you're attracted. You don't have any choice over attractions. But you do have choice on who you love, and you choose who you're going to love, and you choose who you're not going to love. It is an act of the will. You choose who you love. You choose who you won't love. It's your choice. Love is a choice. If it were simply an emotion, God couldn't command it. You can't command an emotion. I command you to be happy when you're sad. I command you to be funny. I command you. No, you can't command an emotion. Love is a choice. Number two, love is an action. It's something you do. It's not something you talk about. Love creates feelings, really good feelings, but love is far more than a feeling. It's an action and it's a choice. And it's easier to act your way into a feeling than feel your way into an action. It's far more than words or emotions. It's behavior. And so you can actually practice choosing to act in loving ways. And if you don't feel loving, just start acting loving. Guess what? The feelings will come. Love is like a muscle. You strengthen it with practice. You strengthen it with use. And you get better at it. You get more skilled at loving. You know what my prayer is for you? My prayer is that a year from today, you're going to be a lot more skilled in loving everybody, even people who don't like you. That would make God smile. I don't have the time to cover all the benefits and all the rewards of living a life of love, but I will tell you this. God's word is filled with promises to those who will live a life of Jesus' love, that kind of love, loving the unlovely, loving those who don't want to be loved. You will experience happiness. You'll experience meaning. You will experience satisfaction. You will experience significance and a whole lot more. And as Kay pointed out when she shared that quote of Jesus, only those who give their lives away will ever really know what it means to live. For 4 decades, I've sought to grow, and I've got a long ways to go, sought to grow in living a life of love. I have loved you. I've even learned to love some critics and some enemies. I've loved some people who are pretty unlovable. But you know, if I had it to do all over again, the thing I'd change is this. I'd be more loving than I was. I'd be more loving than I was. This is the greatest thing you can do with your life. The most important thing, the highest aim, seek it. Nothing matters more. It's most important, God says. Let me end with a testimony about love. Some of you are going through tough times right now. If you'll build your life on love, and love is the motivation for what you do, you can get through tough times that you never thought you'd get through. One of the greatest benefits you get when love is your motivation is that love gives you tremendous endurance to keep going when things are painful. I know this from personal experience. Some of you know that I was born with a very rare brain disorder, and I've had it all my life, and I've been to Mayo Clinic and all the best doctors you can find, but nobody's given me a cure for it at this point. But one of the side effects of this syndrome is that it often makes public speaking excruciatingly painful to me. You got you? Yeah. You can't tell it. You can't tell it from my appearance. But those who are closest to me, they have known the agony that I've gone through every time I teach. And, you know, I really thought it was crazy that God chose me to be the pastor of a large church who experiences pain every time you speak. Because when we started the church, I told God that I could handle preaching for one service, but I could never do it twice. It'd just be too painful. But as we grew, we kept adding services and went from 2 to 3, then 4 services, then 5 services, then 6 services, and then 12 more services back to back on holidays. And I'll just be honest with you. Honestly, it was like going through a torture chamber repeatedly, over and over and over. There were so many times that I wanted to give up. But I never did. And I have pushed through and endured that pain for 43 years. But most people not even knowing about it. Why? Because I was always trying to do what I was doing out of love for God and for you. And anytime people would ask me, Rick, don't you just love to preach? I'd say, no, I don't. It's painful to me. And then they'd ask, well, so why do you keep doing it? And I'd say, I'll tell you why. I don't love to preach, but I love the people I preach to, so I keep on doing it for their benefit, and I am addicted to change lives. And I've endured through 43 years of pain because of love. And I came up with a prayer that I prayed in my mind every single time I've walked across this stage to the podium or the pulpit, or whatever, to teach. And it goes like this. Father, I love you, and you love me. And I love these people, and they love me. And you love these people, and they love you. This is not an audience to perform to. This is not an audience to fear. This is a family to be loved. There is no fear in love. Perfect love casts out all fear. And I will tell you that it was love that kept me going all these 43 years of painful preaching. And by God's grace and by his love, I made it to the finish line. That is the power of love, to endure and to overcome difficult situations. I don't know what situation you're going through right now, but if you'll inject love into it, your persistence, your determination, your diligence, your endurance will go up because you have a reason for doing what you're doing, and it's a reason beyond yourself. It's for Jesus' sake. It's because you love the Father. It's because you love the Holy Spirit. It's because you love the people that Jesus died for. I want to pray for you. Would you bow your heads? And I invite you to just pray this prayer yourself. Say, Lord, I want to say yes to you today. And I want to live a life of love. I'm tired of shallow living and petty thinking. I want to say yes to God. I want to put aside comfort and control and fear and selfish ambition. I want to take up the cross and I want to follow you. I want to be, Jesus, an expression in a visible way of the invisible God. Say, Father, I want to live a life of love just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as an offering and a sacrifice. Say, Father, I want everything I do to be done with love. Help me to remember that love is more important than anything else. It's what holds everything together. And for the rest of my life, I want to seek a life of love as if my life depended on it. Help me to remember that if love is not my motivation, nothing I say will matter, nothing I know will matter, nothing I achieve will matter, nothing I will give or sacrifice will matter. Help me to remember that the only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love. And because of this, I commit to these first simple steps. Help me to build the habit of reminding myself over and over throughout the day of how much you love me. I can only love as I sense your love for me. Help me to spend more time with you in your word. And I'm asking you to make me a more loving person, the Jesus kind of love. And I'm committing to begin practicing in choosing to act in loving ways. Even when I don't feel loving, I'm going to choose to do the loving thing. Thank you for your love for me. Thank you that I can always depend on it. If you've never invited Christ in your life, remember that verse Kay said that Christ died for us because he loved us. Say, thank you for loving me enough to die on the cross. Say, Jesus Christ, come into my life today. Save me. I pray, Father, that everyone listening, that a year from today, we'll be better skilled in loving like Jesus. That we'll be more practiced in living a life of love. And that Saddleback Church will be known not for its size or its programs or anything else, but that's where people love. I pray that as we walk in love, you will give us the endurance to handle the problems and the pain of life. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
What's your next step in your faith? Here at Saddleback, we'd love to help. Maybe it's discovering what it means to belong to a church family, being part of a small group, or using your God-given gifts to serve others. Find the nearest campus by visiting saddleback.com/locations or visit Saddleback's online campus at saddleback.com. To download the transcript of this message, visit pastors.com and explore other resources for purchase. Have a great week!